Good evening, wherever you are in the Bay Area or beyond. I saw somebody on here from Philly. I was like, wow, that's kind of late for meditation, but hold it down, Philly. We with you, you know? So it's so sweet. I am so happy that this Sangha is going Thursday night. You know, Thursday night has always been near and dear to my heart. I mean, I remember starting the Sangha when we were just 7 or 8 people on 23rd and Broadway when we had our little location. And I remember we didn't even have any heat and it was cold outside and we were just in there, 7 of us, like, yay, POC Sangha. So it means a lot that we're still gathering. And I just want to welcome all of you and just like, wow, I really miss this community so much. It's like I've been here and there and all over. And now it just feels so right to be back on Thursdays and offering some heart medicine, some teachings, and just being together. So I welcome all of you who might be new or some of you who just been here every week. And I see Miss Candy holding it down at EVMC all the time and some other regulars. And I want to give just so many thanks to all the volunteers like Evan and all of you who make this happen. You know, it's our sacred service. It's our dharma. It's our seva. Without communities holding the pieces, you know, we all have our tasks to do, isn't that? And we do them with love and we hold things together. So gratitude for that. And so we are going to do a little bit of meditation practice. We're going to sit for about 30 minutes, which is really nice because I actually really do need to practice. You know, I don't just fake these things. I really do practice when it's practice time, you know, so I'll say a few things, but then I'm going to put my video camera just on mute and you can see me, you know, meditating away. But I really do also, like all of us, I need to always be grounded right now. You know, the energy is so, it's just moving in a lot of directions and we'll get to that. But to take the time, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, but to have 30 minutes where you can just follow your breath, be in your body, you know? So really giving your practice your whole heart, even if you feel like screaming or jumping up or, you know, just sitting with whatever's there with love. You know, we just loving presence, whatever's happening, boredom, happiness, sorrow, tears. You know, we just keep grounding. We keep rooting down. There's something so powerful about that, you know, in whatever position is comfortable for you. And so, and then I'm going to talk about the Dharma of Harriet Tubman, because, you know, me and Harriet, we're on a journey right now. And I got to share some of these things with you all. Some of these things I'm learning. So I'm excited to talk about that and just, yeah, and our ancestors and just voices from the underground. Yeah, it's deep. They're out there right now. Our ancestors are talking, all of our ancestors. So we want to weave that in with also, what does our Buddhist ancestry say? You know, what are the Bodhisattvas saying? What are the awakened ones saying? You know, so all of this is, I think, going to weave into a juicy Dharma talk. And some time for Q&A, because I really want to make some time to hear your feedback. I wish we had time for groups. You know, I do love groups, you know. I think gathering is so sweet. But we got a lot to squeeze in to a short period. So I'm watching the clock so I can stay, so I can get to everything, you know. So just again, welcome everybody. I'm just so happy to be with our Thursday EVMC tribe. Always my favorite community, no matter where I go. So yeah, we're here together, holding it down. So on that note, we will now move into the sitting and just do your best again, you know, whatever feels comfortable. Again, we always want to be trying to root in the body, to connect to the body, grounding in the body. The body is hard because a lot of our emotions are in the body. So we always want to jump out, you know, we want to run away. But the more that we can try to just be with a lot of love and compassion. So tonight, Focus on the gentleness with being in your body. Kindness. Put your hand on your heart. My God, our hearts are holding so much. Our bodies are holding all of the tension and the complexity. So you want to soften. You want to attune to your body, right? It's like a gentle coming in. Be like water tonight. Just flow. Let the breath flow. Soften. So as you begin to close your eyes, and I'll ring a little bell just to start, because I have this favorite bowl of mine, crystal quartz, and just allowing your body, so we just transition. Mindfulness bells. The bells of the temple are ringing. And so we come in and we just begin as we begin to close our eyes. And I'll guide it along for a few moments and then we'll just sit quietly together. But really soften your body. Imagine that you're coming down into your body from the crown. And so maybe you need to move your neck and your shoulders around, especially your shoulders. We are carrying literal weight on the shoulders. So you might feel tension, heaviness in the shoulders. So just maybe rotating them. We want to soften. We want to allow our immune system, the autonomic nervous system, to begin to settle. So that happens when we feel safe and when we use the breath and we're softening. So let your shoulders be soft. Let your face and your jaw soften. Any place that feels tight. And as you begin to feel your arms and your hands, notice how your hands are placed and soften them. If they're folded, become aware of the hands touching. We want to be using contact with the body. Mindfulness of the body is the first foundation, how we develop awareness, how we grow in presence is by focusing on sensations in the body. So now bring your awareness to your belly. And I always like to take some deep belly breaths, especially the area right under the belly button, actually. So taking some breaths, notice how the belly feels, or this midsection of the body. See if you can soften. Expand the breath. Let the belly just be completely loose, and any tension, any holding, let go with each breath. We not only digest food in the belly, we digest life energies. So this is a place of a lot of tension, a lot of chronic holding. So with each breath, just imagine you're just letting go on the out-breath, any excess energy, any tension, any tightness. And now begin to feel where your sitting bones are touching the chair. If you're sitting on the couch, feel the couch. If you're sitting in an upright seat, feel the contact of your hips and your sitting bones. Just feeling the whole body, and see if, as you begin to notice, if you can straighten your aligning your posture a little bit, but not in a tense way, but just in a way that allows the breath, allows our circulation, our energy to flow. But comfortable, we're soft. There's no trying to get anything. We're just being right now. We are being loving awareness. And so using your touch points of your seated position, feeling contact of the hands, contact of the legs on the floor or your feet on the floor. This is how you root down. Not so much lost in the mind, but feeling connected to your body. Maybe you haven't felt that connection all day, so now is the time. Connect, soften, and be kind in your feeling tone, kindness in your awareness. Again, we're just noticing how the body feels. We've focused on the rhythm of the breath as the anchor. Maybe you feel your breath in your belly or the chest. Or maybe you feel the breath in the nose area or through your whole system. Notice where you feel the in-breath, the movement of the rising, and then the out-breath. And you don't have to force or control. This is just the breath in its natural way. And for these moments while we practice together, allow yourself to feel that safety of just this moment. Even if there's emotions present, name them: happy, sad, bored, afraid. However it is, it's on time, organic. And whatever the moment brings us, our practice is to be with it, to open, to feel, one breath at a time. So coming back, past and future concepts, all we have is this moment, the sensations of our legs and our bones touching and our hands and the rhythm of the breath. And take your time, one moment at a time, one breath at a time. We'll practice in this way for the next 20 minutes or so. Presence, awareness, kindness. Find your breath. Find your body. And there you will find the present moment. Continuing to soften your body. Notice if any tension is building up in the shoulders or the neck. Again, we want to be softening tension, releasing any area that feels tight and is clenching. So with each breath, see if you can continually soften, release. Become present of any place in the body that feels tight. And just put your awareness there. See if you can breathe into that place. Any place that feels achy or hard or contracted. Again, allowing the breath to be like water flowing, moving through our energetic system. Healing us on a cellular level. Becoming present. And for the last few moments of our sitting, offering some loving kindness practice, compassion. So the metta practice is a way that we offer friendliness, send loving wishes to ourselves. We send our light, our friendly, caring, compassionate, loving energy intentionally as practice. So I always like to do this with my hand on my heart, or you can put your right hand in your left hand, or just visualize yourself in any moment. If you have a photo, or just imagine sitting in front of yourself. And we just want to do some affirmative messages, some words, offers. May I be happy and peaceful. And see if you can take that in on the in-breath. And we know that things aren't always happy and peaceful, but we all beings long for happiness and peace in their lives. So we offer that deeply to ourselves. May I be happy and peaceful. Or you could say your name, or you could imagine the image and say, may you, dear one, be happy and peaceful. We offer, may I be safe and protected. We protect those that we love, our children, our pets, our elders. We protect ourselves. So may I be safe and protected. Wherever I go, may I be safe and protected. See if you can just breathe that on the in-breath from the ground, Panchamama, the universe. Just as we breathe in, imagine rainbow light, golden colored light. We just fill our bodies up. May I be healthy and strong in this body. Sending love, strengthening the immune system. Our bodies respond to compassion. They respond to all emotion. They respond to all thought vibration. So sending care to your body, especially if you're not feeling well or there's aches or pains. May this body be healthy, strong, radiant. May I live with ease and joy and well-being with however things are in this moment. So this we say to the present moment. We bow to things as they are. May I live with ease and joy with life at this time. And any other words that come of compassion for difficulties that we all hold, the fear, the love, the joy, the sorrow, we bow to it all. We bow because we are willing to be present with all of this in this moment in history, this moment in time, this moment on this gathering. We're present, awake. And we bow to ourselves as we close out our practice, bow to our hearts, bow to our intention, bow to however you are making it through these moments of your life with dignity and wisdom. We bow to all of our sanghas and practitioners holding truth, holding wisdom, walking in peace for the benefit of all beings. I've been listening to so much gospel music these days. Yeah, Mahalia Jackson, I'm on my way. Wow, I could have just had a whole gospel Dharma talk. Maybe I just need to do that the next time. We just play songs and then talk about it and then play more songs and then dance and then play more songs and pray. Maybe that's what I need to do for my day long. I'm not doing traditional Dharma these days. It just can't, you know, the kind of Dharma where we're all frozen for long periods and we're very serious. You know, it's more of a heartfelt celebration. And I think I've always been like that. For those of you who know me, you know, I don't think I'm very, I don't usually come from a lot of intellectual concepts. I more care about how I feel my practice. Right? What's happening in my body? What's happening in the heart, you know, and how I'm being affected. So, since I haven't seen you all in so long, and just looking at, I just like going through the names here and just seeing the folks holding it down. Yes, so good. And so, I want to talk a little bit about Harriet Tubman. Yes, and my very interesting relationship with Harriet. And I see Briani on the phone, or Briani was in my class, and some of you might have been in my 5-week class about Harriet Tubman. But you know, that class was very interesting because I thought it was going to be all people of color, and then it was like 85% were white. And I was like, what? You know, every week I'd be looking through, like, you know, and I just didn't know where to. I don't know where that came from, you know, and I'm okay with that. But then I really missed that we couldn't get into things in a different way, you know? And so I want to just tell a few stories and a little bit about how I'm making it through this time, how you all are doing. You know, I was talking to a friend, and I'm writing this blog about, you know, telling people that there's a crack in the matrix right now. And that crack, in a way, there's a lot of magic floating around. Yes, it's a lot of heavy energies, as we know. We just had this beautiful full moon in Aquarius, which changed the whole vibe. So now we're moving much more into yin, water flowing. We got to be flowing. You know how you let things just go, you know? It's like it's not too, you can't hang on to a lot right now. Right? When you try to hang on to something, what happens? It runs, right? So you got to be like flexible, like water makes its way through movements and cracks in the earth, right? It's flowing, it's like yin and moving your body, connecting to water spirits right now is very powerful. Cleansing, bathtubs, like, you know, water is very powerful in every tradition, in Amazonian shamanism and ritual. You know, what happens with water, right? We bathe with it, baptism, cleansing old energies. There's a lot of magic right now because there's this crack. I can see it. It's like in the matrix, but the matrix is so compelling, right? Samsara, right? It's just so loud. It's like every. Right. You gotta have an ability to tune that out, right? And focus, like, and hear what's important to hear. So I'm glad you all are on this call and practicing, because the more that you're practicing meditation, when you know what you're really doing with meditation is you're listening, right? That's what we're doing. Meditation, mindfulness, the word for mindfulness is remembering, right? So when you sit, imagine that you're listening. You're listening to the heart. You're listening to the sound of silence. You're listening to the trees. Maybe you're listening to the sirens going by. You know, it's okay to be urban landscape or nature, right? We're listening, and that listening is very powerful right now because samsara is so loud. And so, if you carve out times to listen to this higher frequency, you're going to be better for it, right? You're going to rise above all the drama. And it's heavy, it's thick, right? I mean, it's like you know, your fight, we're all like slicing through, right? And it's just heavy. And so that's okay, because there's a teaching in that. You know, we're here. This is our task, to be present with this. This is our karma. This is our experience. This is our teaching. And so I think a lot about, you know, what is inspiring? How are you getting through? Where are you finding that inspiration? So I'm so happy that you're practicing even 5 minutes a day, you know, even 1 minute, even one breath, you know, pat yourself on the back, because sometimes it can be very hard to get in a period of real practice, right? Even for me, it's hard. And I'm a Dharma teacher, supposedly. I'm just out here doing what I can, you know? We're all learning together, right? There's no high, low, we're just all growing together. So a crack in the matrix. Yeah, somebody wrote, Jamil wrote, I appreciate that. That's a powerful vision I have a lot of times, because with this crack, it's like for those who are hearing, there's what happens in the crack is that's where the channel where higher knowledge is, you know, that's where we can tap into insight. Right? It's trying to wake us up, right? If we could just tune down all the noise. And it's like, it's almost like, you know, we're climbing up to higher altitude, you know? And it's like, okay, I'm hearing the wise voices. And then we get pulled down again, right? And it's like, drama, and this is happening, and the president, and what's happening, you know, this is going on. And it's hard because it hurts. Oh my God, the news just breaks my heart. Just, I can't really look at it. It's too terrible. I just skim the headlines, you know, like don't give a lot of energy to that. It is samsara times 10. It is the matrix so amplified, so crazy town. Don't spend your time on that, right? Eyes on that crack, right? What's coming through me? What's arising in you right now? Because if you can keep attuning to that crack, what's going to happen is beautiful, inspired energy is there. A kind of magic of manifestation right now. And I don't really talk about manifestation. You know, I'm not somebody who, even though I kind of grew up in the New Thought Church, I don't really use that language like, oh, manifest. I'm going to manifest this. You know, I don't usually have a vision board with cars on it. That's not really me, right? That's like, okay, that's okay, you know, but that's not the highest potential, you know, for my life. However, if you have a heartfelt, clear vision for your life, things move quickly right now. There's something about that crack being there that there's like an acceleration point happening. Do you feel me on that? Does anyone feeling that? Like you align with compassion and love. It's like you're going to go on. It's like you're on the freeway, and then all of a sudden the traffic's clear and you can go really fast. And so things are happening a lot faster, right? They're flowing faster. Things are dissolving, moving quicker, quicker and quicker and quicker. I know the Joanna Macy used to always say, or I think it was Joanna, she used to say, things are happening faster and faster, quicker and quicker at the same time. They're getting better and worse, faster and faster, quicker and quicker at the same time. We can feel that, right? We know that's going to happen. So that brings me So I was feeling this, right, the last few months, and I remember how my whole schedule in 2020, like all of our schedules, it just got washed down the river, right? I wasn't even supposed to be living in the U.S. I had abandoned internally. I was in South America. I had been a nomad for the last 2 years. Basically going to go through the residency process of being a Peru resident. I was like, bye-bye, America. You know, kind of like, you can kiss my, you know, that kind of energy. Like, but here I am. No mistake there, right? I got stuck here. And now I'm so happy, right? And I, in March, I had to come back from this retreat. They closed this retreat center and all my retreats in Peru were canceled. And I just didn't know what I was going to do. You know, I thought my whole life is gone. I didn't even have anywhere to live here. And I remember I spent a month doing a grief ritual over it up in Mendocino. I was on Alice Walker's property and she has this fireplace that's so profound. And I would light these massive fires. And I swear, she told me her land is a temple. And I would light these fires and literally the fire would start dancing. It would start doing its own magic. It would start putting out all this smoke. And one day when I was sitting there praying in the fire, I could literally see smoke signals. It was like black smoke, 1, 2, 3. And I sat and watched it for a long time. And I was like, there's signals going out to the spirit world from right here, right? Smoke signals. And that gave me so much inspiration. It was like my prayers were being carried. And so I was like, all right, back to the Bay Area. What you got in store for me, universe, right? Let's do this. I'm here. I'm in America. I'm joining the cause, right? And so out of that moment of confusion and despair and George Floyd's death, all of that has such a profound effect on me and all of us, as I know, as you know, all of us collectively, Harriet Tubman started to pay me visits. It started with a dream a couple of days before George Floyd's murder, where I was, you know, in dream time, we all have these collective dreams, don't we? The Freudian psychology is we're always being chased. You know, if you haven't had a dream, like you're being chased, usually monsters, you know, and we're being chased. So there I was being chased and it was dark. I couldn't see and I'm holding on and I'm running. And I knew it was Harriet Tubman. And I remember saying, Harriet. She was like, uh-huh. And we're running. And I feel we're being chased. Like, it's dangerous. And I was thinking, am I on the Underground Railroad? Where are we? You know, and it's like, you know, the symbolism, archetypal imagery, dark road, can't see, being led, right? And Harriet was like, I'm going to get you out of here. Because I remember I was crying like, Harriet, help, get me out. And I'm running, holding on to the back of her coat, barely. You know, Harriet Tubman spent years running all over from Maryland to Canada to Philadelphia to New York. She was a runner, right? Always running, always guiding people. So that led me into this very mystical relationship with this great ancestor of ours. And I wanted to evoke Harriet for those of you who haven't participated in any of my classes. And that's okay, because this is perfect that I can talk about her now, is that she's very alive ancestor for all of us right now. Her spirit is out. Her energy is out. And the transmission that we can get is one of courage. Unbelievable power and courage to keep on conducting, because that's what we are. We are conductors. Teachers are conductors. You are a conductor of something. You're a healer, teacher. What are you? A community leader in some way, right? All of us are conducting. Conductors of love, conductors of truth. And the biggest obstacle that we have right now, I don't know for you, but for me, is fear, right? Of being killed, speaking out, speaking truth to power, right? It's like, oh my God, the police, or what if I say this? You know, we have this clamp down right now, right? There's a backlash against truth tellers. And there was always a backlash against Harriet. And so Harriet's like, so what? You got to keep on going. When you're a conductor, that's what you do, right? You keep going. So I've had this deep, profound relationship with Miss Harriet. I'm like, I have this giant poster. I should have put it behind me. I was filming something else earlier, a different class. And but you could come to my Sunday class, the church. That's where we play gospel songs and I'm like, hallelujah. And I tell stories because I'm learning so many stories. So here's the magical part, my friend. So I start having these visions about Harriet. I don't know what it's about, you know, on a deeper level. I'm like, okay, so I do this 5-week class. The class is very popular. All these people log on. And then my publisher logs on. And my publisher is a Hay House publisher. And I'm working on this shamanic book that I've been already a year behind. You know, I'll tell you the truth. I'm the world's slowest writer. I'm just not a writer. It's an imposter syndrome. But everyone keeps trying to get me to write stuff. I'm like, okay. She logs on and she says, Spring, you need to stop writing this shamanic book and get a book about Harriet out right now. So now I'm in this deep thing with Harriet, writing stories. All of this has come out of 3 months ago. None of this existed. So I asked the universe, what am I supposed to do? I'm a healer. I am a conductor. The universe is like, we got a whole new plan. And that's the same for all of us. If you can have deep faith in whatever it is that you're going through, because some of us, it's a dissolving process. Right? Everything has to go. It's like a flood, you know, and it just washes out all the junk, right? Or like a fire or something, right? It just burns away relationships, people, jobs, anything that's not in alignment. We do have to let it go, right? And then out of that, there's something new that can be born, something much more powerful. And I was talking, as I've had many conversations with Alice Walker, Alice always says, it'll be a Black woman who saves this world, just so you know. You know, she's been saying this for years. And that's not to diminish. And Black could be anyone of color. I do believe that. Black is an internal setting too. You know what I mean? But I get the feeling it will be someone like a Harriet, you know? Like a young, involved, like, you know, something, but also, you know, our power, you know, reminding ourselves. And I feel like that's what Harriet is teaching me, is about power, how to be fearless. And so some of the beautiful stories about Harriet, and also how to trust our connection to spirit. Harriet was also a prophet, you know, she had this incredible connection with spirit. You know, this ability to foresee the future, this powerful connection to her intuitive abilities. You know, she got a head injury when she was young. She was would refuse to restrain a slave. You know, there was a battle in a store she was at when she was a child, and a slave had ran away from its owner, and the owner was trying to wrestle him, and he said, ask Harriet, grab him, help me grab him. And she said, no, you know, and no matter. And then she was, and then he threw this weight and it hit her in the head. And after that, she began to have what she calls our visions, you know, and sometimes she would fall unconscious for long periods. And every time she woke up, she had a new life vision. She was like, yep, I know where to go. I know how to lead this. I know when I need to go. I know who I need to rescue, where I need to get my family out, the route to take. And she foresaw everything that would happen in her life. She actually foresaw the Civil War. She knew that was going to be a battle. And so Harriet, you know, the thing that also makes me the most sort of inspired by her is that no matter how many beatings she had, you know, born a slave, no matter what they said to her, she never believed it. She was like, I might be an enslaved person by the mad people around here, but she didn't identify. It was like she always knew that she was Moses. Like, that's not who I am. And so when I'm talking to Harriet, you know, I feel like I'm writing this book that's kind of channeled in a way. So I ask these questions like, Harriet, where are you from? And she's like, oh, you want to know where I'm from? You want to know where this story started? Oh, honey, it didn't start when I was born Mitzi in Maryland in 1922. This goes way, way. And it's like, oh, I was like, okay. You know. She's like, I've been Moses for lifetimes. This isn't my first my first life, you know, as a conductor, you know. And it's just really profound to think about our lives in those terms, you know. And all of us have this power. And I feel like that is a message that I'm writing about, is like our power, our voice. Like, where are we afraid? And how can we liberate that fear? How can we step boldly into the dreams that we want to create, the life that we want to manifest? You know, I have so much faith in the Dharma that a lot of the visions that we care about are usually steeped in compassion. I mean, how many of you are just thinking of really like self-centered things? It's not like that, right? When you're on the spiritual path, your vision actually is a powerful one that has a community-based integrative approach, right? We want to bring forward something that is for the benefit of others. That's always the highest, you know? And, you know, I'm learning that from Harriet. Harriet was a great bodhisattva. She cared about liberating people. The journey of her when she was 27 to finally escape was years in the making of watching what she just could not stomach anymore. And she just, you know, was pretty fearless in that. You know, she was ready to go. And I want to tell you guys a funny story, because I've got all these books and Underground Railroad and stories, Frederick Douglass. And I show you my desk. It's just a pile of research. And I'm just so happy that there's something very powerful about this happening to me right now, because Harriet Tubman is changing the entire course of my life, because I will spend the rest of my life talking about Harriet Tubman. When you write a book about something, that's your task. Right? My task is to get this done. I don't know how I'm gonna get this done in 4 months. That's the deadline. So pray for me on that, you know. Send me some love and light that I can finish this. I'm gonna really try. I'm not even gonna try, I'm gonna do, because when I think about what Harriet did, I'm like, girl, you better get up. You better get out of that bed and start writing, you know. Harriet led people for 10 years. You know, walking. Do you know she led missions all the way from Maryland to the border of Canada? 600 miles walking. Fearless. Just fearless. I love that. Don't we love somebody like John Lewis, you know, arrested 50 times? You know, it's like, you know, that's some people, that's their task. They come knowing that they're going to do that. Harriet said, I was born knowing I was going to be a conductor, and that's what I did. And all of us has a task. All of us has a task. Some of us are going to be like John Lewis, who knew he was going to get arrested when he got on a freedom riding bus through the South. He knew it. He was just waiting, right? But some of us have other tasks to do. And so to really think deeply, like, what is your soul task, right? Some it's cooking for others, right? And sharing that. And some it's organizing. And some it's speaking out. Some it's writing. Some it's creating programs. All of us have a task. And as communities of color, our task is sacred. And we must not let anything interfere with that. Especially all this drama, all these crazy white supremacists, you know, they just try to get in the way of the task, right? We have to remember that crack in the matrix. There's something higher. There's a higher road pulling us onward. And I'm not just saying that to cheer people up. I really feel this deeply, every fiber of my being. There's a lot of spirit activity right now. Angels, bodhisattvas. I meet a lot with healers and shamanic practitioners, and they're like, whoa, you know, it's the Kali Yuga. It's the dark age. And the dark age, what happens? Light comes, right? It's like, it's an antidote. And so that's also in us, our highest spirit, the highest part of ourselves, our Buddha nature is also speaking to us right now. So I think what I'm going to do is just say a couple more things because I did want to tell a story about Harriet. I forgot which one I was going to say. Oh, Harriet. Yes. So Harriet, just real quick, Harriet left the plantation where she was being enslaved when she was 27. And the first attempt that she made, Harriet was very close to her family. She came from a family of 9 children. 3 of her sisters were sold into down south, and it was very traumatic for her whole family. 1 sister was sold at one time and then 2 at the same time, and she never saw them again, and that just broke her heart. But she had her brothers and her parents that she was very close to. So her first escape, she went with her 2 brothers, and they got way out, you know, they were gone. But what did her brothers do? They got scared and tired and they wanted to turn around. And Harriet was like, no, no, I see where we need to go. I know where we need to go. I know the way. And they didn't believe her and they forced her back, right? And Harriet said, after that, I will never listen to anybody else tell me, you know, the way. I knew I could get out. So then they went back and suffered all the suffering of that, you know. And then quickly after that, Harriet escaped. And funny enough, she went back on other missions and got those 2 brothers out and all the way to Canada. So she did liberate them. But there's something about Harriet saying, never again, you know. I will never be derailed when I know my path. To me, that's a very clear sign. Don't let others turn you around, right? You have your task. You have your mission. You know what the heart is saying. You know what your spirit says. Be careful of people forcing you backwards, right? Believe in yourself. Believe in that. That story was just coming through right now, so I just wanted to share it with you. And yeah. Oh, so many more. So if you want to learn more, you got to come on to my Sunday class, The Church of Harriet. It's a all on generosity. It's 10 o'clock on Sundays. You can learn a lot more there. But I wanted to see if anyone had any questions. Everyone's saying it's resonating. George Floyd and happened and catapulted. Yes, me too. George Floyd. Oh man, I was just so brokenhearted over. I didn't even know what to do with myself. I had this grief that was from the depths of just, all I could do is just roll around for a while on my bed, just crying and praying. And that's when Harriet started coming. So know that there's power. And I do feel like George Floyd is with Harriet. Harriet, when her last dying words were, I will go and make a place for you. The very famous Christian prayer, I go to make a place for you. And in my heart, I feel like she has all of them. Oscar Grant, Breonna Taylor. At least that's what I like to hold on to. That's my vision, what I choose to think about. So I love to hear questions or anything. Yeah, we have some time here. Man, class just goes so fast. But we got some time for questions. So with questions, yeah, Eric Gardner, all of them, I believe they're all together somewhere in a beautiful place. I do believe that. I feel like these ancestors just came and got them. You know, Dr. King is there and Mandela and they're all, yes. Yes, they're helping what's happening. So questions, anybody? And you could just unmute yourself. How about that? Because I'm terrible with looking for hands. I'll be here all night just looking around, you know. So if you'd like to make a comment or ask a question, yeah, let's do that. Oh, yeah. So there's a lot of emotions that have to be purified right now, right? That we have to, and if you're having a flood of emotions, know that you are not alone. Okay. First of all, I need to do a class. It may be one I do for EBMC, The Dark Night of the Soul, because everybody's writing me like, Spring, is this it? I have all the symptoms, and it's so many emotions. So, my friends, if that is your experience, if it's grief, if it's rage, if it's terror, you've got to find a way to see that as your task right now. That is the task, that is clearing out something. And I'll tell you what, a lot of the stuff that's coming up is this old stuff, that like our family, the pain of our family tree, right? Old stuff, relationships. That's another thing. People are like, oh my God, all I think about is all my exes right now. I thought I was over it. It's like all the unfinished ex-boyfriends, girlfriends, lovers, all of it, you know, whoever you've ever been with, right? It's any unfinished business of the heart. It's because you can't take all that with you. So the flood is the cleansing of that. And if you're in that experience, if it feels overwhelming, which it does, oh my God, a dark night of the soul is the flood. And it really is something dying so something can be reborn. It really is a death, and it's something you just have to surrender to. And the task that you have is to be with that with as much care and grace as you can. That is a sacred process. That is a holy process. We are untangling tangles that have been tied up for 1,000 years or more, right? Tangling our energy, right? Blocking the vision. Right? So you can't see the vision yet because it's too much stuff there. But have faith that as that energy untangles, as we let go, our task becomes more clear. Right? We've got the road has to get cleared before we can see, you know, which way. So trust where you are. The task could be to do the deepest inner work of your whole life right now. And if that's what you're called to do, surrender to that. Light candles on your altars, buy yourself some flowers, and just surrender and say, all right, spirit, I'm not going to fight this. I'm going to just feel the grief. I'm going to feel the rage. I'm going to feel whatever I need to feel and allow it as best you can. And I know that's really hard. And that is a beautiful question. And I had that for a month after I came back. And I still have a lot of emotions around all this. Some days I feel a lot of sadness. It's just tears. Other days I feel happy. Right now it's very much like a roller coaster, right? High, high, highs and low, low, low feelings can come all in a period of 3 hours, you know? So we have to be like, as I said, you have to be like water right now. Just let the feelings just leave, just open to them, tears out, flowing. It's all icebergs melting, things untangling. Trust that. Trust your ability to be present with that too. Okay. So yeah, that's, and I think I'm going to be doing a class for EBMC very soon, and it's going to be on this kind of dark night energy where it's like, we feel like we're dying and the flood is carrying us away, you know? And, but there's joy in that. When you get through that, the birth, it's always glorious. So hang on. It doesn't stay like that. Hang on. Yeah, that's a good one. Well, it's definitely not a narrowing down, you know, like you could have so many projects, but they're all sort of going. Usually if you have a soul task, like say you're a teacher, it's like you might have many projects, but they're going in the same direction. You know, they're all just like different roads on getting, you know, helping people, right? If that's what you're conducting is like, say you're a health, you know, you're teaching people about mental health. You might have many roads into that, many different approaches. And I think for that, you just have to listen to your heart. A lot of times we know, but our mind gets in the way, right? Or our sense of like, let's be practical. Right. I don't want to let go of my job at the bank, right, to do this thing, but that thing is all we want to do, right? So we battle the head and the heart a lot, right? And so now it's about listening to the heart. Right now, that's the time. Like, you know, it's like, and we do want to be mindful of the head. But you know, our task is we know it and it's unfolding. And it comes out of this listening. It comes out of your practice. It comes out of your body, right? You just stand up and you find yourself just walking in a certain direction. You're like, that's my task, you know, in this moment. It might be you having a baby. It might be you with your lover. It might be, you know, it's so many different things. It might be you painting or singing or creating. Being creative right now is very important. Let your creativity flow right now. Finger paint or drawing, it gets us into this other field of our spirit, you know? And so you just have to trust you'll know it. It'll come knocking on your door. This thing with Harriet, if you told me about this 4 months ago, I would have laughed. I'd be like, I'm in Peru. I got 2020 is mapped. I don't, Harriet Tubman book, what, you know? I mean, I saw the movie, but I didn't have, like, it's a whole nother life now. So I'm open though. So if you stay open, you know, you'll receive that. If you stay open, you'll receive that. And you'll know, you'll just know. You'll just get up one morning and you'll just say, this is what I'm doing. And you'll trust it. And the more you move forward, the more you'll trust the direction your heart's being called. Right? We start to trust our intuitive knowing, right? And we stop doubting that. We start doubting ourselves. So the task, fulfilling the task is also fulfilling you on a deeper level because it's leading us onto a different road. It's leading us, it's a teaching task, right? It's teaching us ourselves, teaching us our own nature. So that's what's beautiful. But it's always a little bit hard. You got to have some challenges, you know, it doesn't just come like that all the time. Even something that appears easily when we get into the nitty gritty, it's like, oh, okay, this is like really intense, you know, that's okay. Don't be scared of that. That's just part of it, you know, that's just what you get in earth realm, right? It's always a little bit hard. There's always a leak in the boat. That's just, you just got to roll with that leak, you know, the boat will get you there, leaks and all. That's just kind of the fortitude that we get.